Well, hello again. Thank God for you. Thank God for another opportunity to share the Word of God with you. And we thank the Lord for all that He's doing, and God's going to be glorified again today. I just want to share a brief message with you concerning the ministry of deliverance. Folks, because I want you to know the ministry of deliverance is one that is overlooked, that is bypassed, that is neglected by much of the church today. But folks, I want you to know that in the days to come, we're going to need to do a lot of deliverances. And we're going to need to know how to do deliverance, because deliverance was one of the primary ministries of Jesus. And if we're going to follow Jesus, we must operate the ministry of deliverance. And the sad part about it, most church leaders avoid the ministry of deliverance. They do not cast out devils. I remember mentioning a spirit of Python to a pastor about a year ago. He had no knowledge of what I was talking about. What does that tell me? That tells me that much of the church, which means the people as well as the leaders, are out of touch with the ministry of Jesus. They're out of touch with the ministry of deliverance, because this is one that's so important, and it will come to the forefront in the last days and the days that are to come. Like never before, we must understand the ministry of deliverance. One of the duties of every prayer warrior is to learn the ministry of deliverance. Why? Because deliverance operates through prayer. It operates from the basis of prayer and intercession, fasting, prayer, and intercession, because there are some stubborn demons that are not going to come out unless we fast and pray. Jesus said that, and I think it's in Luke chapter 17, and we must understand this ministry, folks, and we must get in a position where we can hear what we have to hear, what we need to hear concerning the ministry of deliverance. Because let me tell you something. The deliverance can save a person's life. Deliverance can save a person's life. If a person is an alcoholic and they don't get deliverance, that alcohol will kill that individual. But if a person is an alcoholic and they seek out deliverance, that alcohol, that person can have years added to their life by getting set free from the spirit of alcohol. You hear what I'm telling you? This is a life and death matter, folks. And some folks are going to have to get deliverance if they're going to fulfill their purpose and if they're going to live out their days. Why? Because demons come to steal, kill, and destroy. Now, there's some things concerning the ministry of deliverance that we need to know. Number one is that Christians can have demons. A Christian can be influenced by an evil spirit. The word is demonized. Christians can be demonized. A Christian cannot be possessed, because if you're a Christian, that means God owns you. You're owned by the Holy Spirit. But possession and demonization is different. Christians can be demonized, but a Christian cannot be possessed by the devil or possessed by an evil spirit. Lost people can be demon possessed. People that don't know God through Jesus Christ, those are the people that get possessed. Now, Christians can be demonized. And Christians need deliverance. I said saved people need deliverance. Saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, still these people need deliverance. We need deliverance, because I just described most of us. You saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, we need deliverance. You're looking at an apostle. You're looking at a minister. You're looking at a brother in the Lord. Hallelujah. You can just call me a brother in the Lord. I have been through a deliverance. I've experienced deliverance, and I still will go through more deliverances. Why? Because deliverance is a process. Deliverance is a process, but there are some people that need deliverance more so than others. I've been through some deliverance, and I minister deliverance to myself. I've been deliverance ministered to me by other deliverance ministers. Hallelujah. I've growled, I've grown, I've manifested. Yeah, that's right. Amen. And those evil spirits left me, and I'm better off for that. So deliverance comes to the humble. See, you got to humble yourself in order to get set free. And you got to realize that you can be controlled by spirits and powers that are not of yourself, that are external, that were sent by the devil. When you got something going on in your life, that you are being driven, that you can't stop, that you have a habit, whether it's drinking, whether it's smoking, whether it's watching pornography, that you're addicted to it and you're driven to do it, cursing, using profanity. All these are signs of demonization. In other words, the demons operating in your life, and the only way to get free from it is to get deliverance, experience deliverance. And pornography is an addiction. And you got a lot of God's people, you got a lot of pastors that they watch pornography, and that leads them into sexual immorality, it leads them into adultery, fornication, but it starts with watching pornography, and that there's a spirit behind that pornography that enters into a person's eyes, and that spirit will drive your life. Folks, I want you to know, deliverance is the children's bread. Jesus said it in Matthew chapter 15, it's not right to take the children's bread and cast it to the dogs. Who he was talking about? He was talking to the Syrophoenician woman who came to him in Matthew 15, who needed deliverance for her daughter who was at home manifesting demons. And Jesus ignored her, but she fell at his feet. She worshiped him. Hallelujah. If you won't get Jesus' attention, just worship him. And she fell at his feet, and she said, Lord, I know it's not right. But he said, but I'll eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. Jesus said, woman, great is your faith. He said, be it unto you as you have desired. And he said, and the Bible says that the spirit was gone out of her daughter that same hour. Why? Because she came to Jesus on behalf of her daughter, and Jesus delivered her daughter that wasn't even in the presence of Jesus. I call it deliverance at a distance. But deliverance is the children's bread. I says deliverance is the children's bread because, see, this woman, the Syrophoenician woman in Matthew 15, she was not a Jew. In other words, Jesus was telling that deliverance is only for the Jews. And it was only for the Jews at that time until Jesus died on the cross. And then once that veil was rent from the top to the bottom, then whosoever will could come into the redemption plan. Whosoever will, Jew, Gentile, black, white, Latino, doesn't matter, Asian, whosoever will could come. But it was after Jesus died on that cross and that veil was torn from the top to the bottom, then the way into the presence of God was open for all men. And all those who become children of God, deliverance is for us. Deliverance is for you. But we've got to humble ourselves and recognize, get rid of the pride, and recognize that we've got bondages, we got addiction in our lives, we got habits that we can't break. Folks, I was a man that cursed. I used profanity to every other word, and I could not stop. I couldn't stop until Jesus saved me, until the Holy Spirit came into my life that day in 1977, drove out some spirits out of my life, and he delivered me from profanity. A person gets delivered when they get born again. They get a partial deliverance when they get born again. They get delivered from some evil spirits. But I want you to know, deliverance is for the believer. I never try to cast a demon out of a lost person. Why? Because number one, they won't stay free, and they don't have the ability to keep themselves free. So deliverance is for the child of God. We got to know that. So don't go minister deliverance to anybody who's not saved. Amen, amen. Now, sometimes I've had to deal with situations where I've cast demons out of people who are not saved. But right after that, you got to lead them to Jesus Christ. You got to lead them to Jesus right after that. If you deliver a person that's lost, right after that, deliver them, that deliverance, lead them to Jesus. I never forget with a young girl one night, she was about 24 years old, at a service, when everybody had left the church, the pastor had gone home, and she started manifesting demons. And they called the pastor and said, this girl is here manifesting demons. The pastor said, y'all handle it, I'm not coming down there. So I was there that night, and I didn't know much about deliverance myself, and I saw how they were doing, and they were trying to hold the girl down, and she was cussing and carrying on and throwing them off. And six men couldn't hold this girl down. And all of a sudden, I sat right there in the chair and I watched it. The Holy Spirit said, don't you move till I tell you. And I only been saved about a few years. And I knew a little bit about deliverance, but not much. But I knew enough to listen to the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Spirit said, okay, said, now go and minister to her. So I got up on my chair. She was laying on the floor. And I said, in the name of Jesus, I whispered in her ear. Didn't yell, didn't scream. And all they were doing is yelling and screaming. And we were getting nowhere. I whispered in her ear. I got down on the floor. I said, in the name of Jesus, you unclean spirit, come out of her. When I said that, she screamed and she manifested. She kicked, threw her hands in the air, stayed on the floor. And she just began to scream and shake violently. And all of a sudden, her body went limp. And the Lord said, the spirit is gone. Now lead her to Jesus. And I went back and I said, I forgot what her name was. I said, okay, I want to call up whatever her name was. And I said, I want to talk to her. And I said, I want you to accept Jesus Christ. She said, are you willing to? I said, are you willing to do it? She said, yes. And I led her to Jesus. And once I led her to Jesus, she sat up. And she said, where am I? What am I doing here? What are all these people around me? She got set free and she got saved. She got delivered and she got saved. If you do deliverance on a lost person, be sure to lead them to Jesus right away. But deliverance basically is the children's bread. Okay, so to know that is important. Another fact concerning deliverance that we need to know: be able to identify the demon by name. Be able to identify the demon by name if possible. It's not always possible to identify the demon by name, but always try to get the name of that spirit. Because if you don't call it by name, it's a, you're not talking to me. You're talking to somebody else. It don't have a right to leave. But if you can deliver it, identify it by name. That's why Jesus asked the man with the legion. He said, what is your name? He said, my name is Legion, for we are many. Boy, it was on there. That's all Jesus needed. But he got the name of the demon, and he cast out the herd of demons that was in this man. In other words, this man had a multitude of other evil spirits, but the strong man was Legion. See, you got to get the name of that strong man, that lead demon. And when that lead demon leaves, it brings a trail of all the other demons with it. Hallelujah. But now sometimes some people can have more than one strong man. More than one strong man. So that's why don't think just because you cast out one spirit that the person is totally set free. If you cast out one strong man spirit, the person manifests and the person body goes limp, or the person just settles down, just continue to minister to that person and say, are there any others there? Are there any other strong man spirits there? And if you are, I call you to the surface. That's what I do. I say, I call you to the surface. And if they start to manifest again, that tells me they got another demon and they got another strong man there. And you deal with that. You deal with it on that, with that method, until the person ceases to manifest. You got to do that until they cease to manifest, because a lot of people get sent out of a deliverance session and they're not totally set free. Our purpose is to get them totally set free. But first, you got to get the name of the demon, if ever possible. And sometimes if they don't give you their name, they say, well, come on. I say, well, come on anywhere. Come on anywhere in Jesus' name. Come on anyhow. You just come out in Jesus' name. But you got to get the person set free. The goal is to get the person free from the demon spirit, because demon spirits come to steal, kill, and destroy. Now, another thing we got to know also concerning deliverance: no two deliverances are the same. In other words, you got to be led by the Spirit in every deliverance session. Why? Because no two deliverances are the same. The methods will be different. The spirits that you're dealing with is different. The person is different. So no, don't think you got a set in stone pattern for deliverance. No, you got to deal with each case based on that case. And you got to be flexible to flow with the Holy Spirit and just deal with that spirit as it has need, or deal with that person as they have need of deliverance. But notice that no two deliverances are the same. So you got to be flexible. You got to have a variety and be led by the Spirit of God in doing deliverance. Also, know this, that fasting and prayer is the foundation for being effective. Every deliverance minister must have a lifestyle of fasting and prayer. If you don't fast and you don't pray, there are going to be some demons. You're going to come up. They're going to beat you. They're going to beat you down, and that person's not going to be free. That's why Jesus said this kind comes out only by prayer and fasting. Why? Because some demons are more stubborn than others. But fasting and prayer will break the power of stubborn demons. Demons like rebellion, demons like stiff neck, demons like the stiff neck spirit, demons like the python spirit, demons like the Jezebel spirit, demons like the religious spirit, and some infirmity spirit, demons of fear, lust. Sometimes they can be stubborn. Amen. Demons of epilepsy, they can be stubborn. Why? Because a lot of these spirits are generational. They've been in the family for a long time. And the only way you're going to get the person free is through fasting and prayer. Fasting and prayer must be the foundation for every deliverance ministry. You got to have a lifestyle of fasting and prayer. You must have a woman present. If a man is going to do a deliverance, make sure you got a female present. Whether it's your wife or another woman there. Men never do a deliverance with just you and one woman. I never do that. I always will have a woman present if I'm working with a woman. Opposite too, with a woman, never do a one-on-one deliverance with a man. You make sure another male is there or another female is there. Have somebody with you, because a lot of times the other person can discern things that you can't discern. And not only that, it's protection. Amen. I say it's protection. That spirit might leave there and say that you tried to molest them or something like that. You tried to rape them or something like that. Have somebody else there with you. Women have another person there, another female, but men never do deliverance with a woman by yourself. And men, be careful how you put your hand on a woman during deliverance. Be careful how you touch a woman. The only place I'll touch a woman on their body is on their head. Amen. And I learned this from Isaiah Saldivar, who's a powerful young deliverance minister. He'll use the Bible, and he'll take the Bible and touch the person with the Bible. He'll take the Bible and just put the Bible on the person's someplace on the Bible. That stirs up demons. They hate the word of God. In other words, just touch them with the Bible as you pray, and touch them with the Bible as you command. But be careful. Never put your hand on a woman's stomach. Never touch her in her chest area. Never put your hand in her back, on her lower back, on her backside. Never put your hand on a woman. In other words, it's in a safe place. It's on her head. I'll touch him on the head, but use that Bible and touch them. Let that Bible, because that devil hates that word of God. Man, if you know that's not Bible, that'll make a manifest right there. So you got to know these things in order to be effective in deliverance. Personal deliverance. Do not have family members present. In other words, if you're doing a personal deliverance with a husband, the wife must be in another room or not there. You're doing a deliverance with a wife, the husband or another family member must not be there. Why? Because the person, you want that person to be free to open up, to speak things that have been happening in their life. And a lot of times, if another family member is there, that person's not going to open up. And if the person don't open up, they don't tell the whole truth, they won't get free. And that's another thing that we emphasize in our personal deliverance. Tell the person to tell the truth. If you're going to ask some questions, tell them they must tell the truth. In other words, truthfulness is a key to deliverance. Why? Because the truth makes us free. That's what Jesus said. You know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Because the demons hate truth, but the person must be truthful. And also identify the demon by name if possible. Okay, notice also that sometimes the demons can make people black out. Sometimes they just might black out. And this happens a lot with a lot of times people who are violent, people who are serial killers. And a lot of times they're questioned by the law enforcement. And they say, what happened to you? They say, I don't know, I just blacked out. And once they came to, they realized they'd murdered about 3 people. Demons make people black out. And they do things they don't even know that they're doing. And you've got to know that demons cause people to black out. Sometimes they'll black out right in the middle of the deliverance. And all you could do is sometimes wait till they come to, or command that spirit to manifest again. Command it to manifest. But sometimes demons will make the person black out. And ask the person, sometimes you can ask the individual, what is your greatest fear? What are you afraid of the most? This is one of my questions that I ask in a deliverance session. What is your greatest fear? And a lot of time you can find out what spirit is operating in that person by finding out what they are afraid of. Because if they say, I'm afraid of snakes, then you're dealing with the spirit of Python. If you say, I'm afraid of dying, you're dealing with the spirit of death. In other words, if you say you're afraid of my husband, in other words, you're dealing with intimidation from that husband. In other words, that spirit of fear, you got to find out what the person's mostly afraid of. And then once you get these things, once you get this information, you'll know that what spirit to go after. Because the spirit is identified by the operation that it does in the person's life. If the person is hateful, if the person is angry, in other words, spirit of anger come out. If the spirit of hates, if they hate their father, they hate their mother, spirit of hatred come out. Amen. You see, because the spirit, the actions or the operation of the spirit identifies the spirit. Amen. A spirit of lust, if a person is lustful, a spirit of lust come out. If the person is jealous, spirit of jealousy come out. You see, you identify the spirit by the function. Amen. If the person is raging, if the person is in a rage, you call out the spirit of rage and command it to leave. Amen. But the spirit is identified by how it functions. Also, look the person in the eye when you're doing deliverance, whenever possible. Because if it's a demon, that person's going to look down. That person's going to keep his eye closed. It'll talk to you by looking down. It'll talk to you with its eye closed. And sometimes I even open the eyelids. And sometimes when you open the eyelids, sometimes you don't see nothing but white, no pupil. In other words, when you see that, that's the spirit of death. You command the spirit of death and suicide to leave that person. Why? Because that demon will not look you in the eye. Amen. If you're anointed, the fire of God, your eyes is like fire to that spirit. And it will not look you in the eye. And that's how you can tell you're dealing with an evil spirit, is that that person will not look you in the eye. But challenge them to look you in the eye. And that's a way to get them to manifest. Also, we got to know when the demon is manifesting. How do demons manifest? In other words, how do you know that the spirit is leaving? Demons manifest and they leave by coughing. They leave by sneezing. They leave by spitting. They leave by crying. Amen. They leave by screaming. They leave by yelling. They leave by groaning, moaning. They leave with these manifestations. They leave by yawning. In other words, the person just keeps yawning, acting like they're trying to fall asleep or they're getting sleepy. These are manifestations of the evil spirits leaving. They also leave by vomiting. Sometimes that's why you got to have hand towels. You got to have a bucket or something to catch whatever they vomit up out of their stomachs. They leave by vomiting. And that vomit and or whatever they excrete from their body is the nest of the demons. Sometimes the demons come out in that nest. Whether it's clearing their sinuses, blowing whatever's in their nose out, up through their mouth, spitting, coughing up things, gagging. They leave through. Sometimes the person has to go to the restroom. Amen. You let them go to the restroom either through passing gas or relieving themselves through the water or relieving themselves with a bowel movement. Sometimes if the person says, I need to go to the bathroom, let them go to the bathroom, because that's a demonic manifestation. That's right. Passing gas. That's right. Because demons are as nothing but air, is spirit, is breath. And however breath is relieved from the body, that's how a demon leaves. Demon can leave through the ear, they can leave through the eyes, they can leave through the mouth, they can leave through the nose, or any other opening in the body that can release air. And so we got to know when the demon is manifesting, and we got to know when the demon is gone. A lot of times when the person relaxes and they cease to manifest, they become quiet and they become still. A lot of times the demon's gone. But you got to also be discerning. You got to be discerning, because demons will hide. Demons will try to hide from you. Because you gotta be discerning to know when they are hiding, because some spirits will hide on you, amen, and make you think they're gone just so you leave them alone, and you go and think the person is free, but the demon just is hiding, amen. So we've got to know these things if we're going to be effective deliverance ministers. You got to know the authority that God has given you through the name of Jesus. You got to know that that's the powerful name that demons have to respond to, that they have to come out when you use the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because he said, in my name you should cast out demons. Mark chapter 16, verse 17. He said, in my name you speak with new tongues. In my name you lay hands on the sick. It's the name of Jesus. You got to have authority. You got to have faith in the name of Jesus coming out of your mouth, that demon's going to respond. And you use the prayer of command. You don't ask the demon to leave. You don't counsel the demon out. You command them to come out in Jesus' name. You use that authority. You use the prayer of command with the name of Jesus, and you'll set many people free. And they'll come out sometimes screaming. They'll come out manifesting in different ways. And another thing we've got to get ready for. Don't let the demon intimidate or scare you. Because a lot of times demons will manifest to try to scare us. They'll manifest with violent behavior. They'll manifest with cursing, using profanity, calling you names, calling you all kinds of evil, ungodly names. They'll manifest just to scare you. Certain manifestations will even try to intimidate you. I've seen a young girl's face contorted right before me. I was ministering deliverance to her, and her face turned into like almost like a Halloween mask. This girl was about 13 years old, and right in front of me, her face twisted up, her nose got big, her eyes stretched, and her face just twisted up right before me. Her face turned into like a Halloween mask before me. What the demon was trying to do? Trying to intimidate me and scare me away from the deliverance. Don't be intimidated by him. And folks, we've got to be ready. For when demons cause people's body to contort, demons can cause people's body to levitate, just suspend in midair right off the floor in order to scare us away. We must not be intimidated by the manifestation of evil spirits, because that's one thing they'll try to do. They'll try to scare us. And we've got to know that we've not been given the spirit of fear, but the power of love and a sound mind. That's why in order to be an effective deliverance minister, we've got to first be delivered ourselves. We got to be delivered from the spirit of fear. And one of the ways we get delivered from the spirit of fear is to develop the fear of God in our life. You develop the fear of the Lord, it delivers you from every other fear. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 29 and 31 tells us, we will be delivered from all fear, but you got to have a fear for God. A reverent respect for God will deliver you from fear. Deliver us from fear when we're doing deliverance. Let's see if we got any more we'll share with you. Okay. Also, ask the Holy Spirit for information on what demon it is. In other words, ask the Holy Spirit to show you what demon that you're dealing with in order that you can get that demon by name and you can deal with it. Okay, and a group, if you're doing a deliverance, if there's a group of deliverance ministers around, only one person, and somebody, you need to be writing this stuff down, you need to be taking notes. Only one person should command the demon to leave. You got five or six people yelling, come out, that's nothing but confusion. And that demon's not going to move because that demon needs to hear one voice of authority, one voice with authority. The others are there. And if you get something, give it to that person who's commanding the demon. You whisper it to that person. And that person who's doing the commanding or doing the deliverance, one person at a time, call out the spirits, command the demon to leave in Jesus' name. You got five or six people yelling and screaming, yelling, come out, come out, and doing us all kinds of stuff. Nothing but confusion. And that demon will sit right there and say, y'all don't know what y'all doing. And I ain't leaving because I don't have no reason to leave. Y'all are not even together. Y'all don't know who I am, and I'll stay right here. This will be my house. Amen. But the purpose of deliverance is for the demon to become homeless. We are here to make demons homeless, to send them to the abyss. And that's where we send them out. That's where when we cast them out, we tell them, go to the abyss. And the abyss is the bottomless pit. We send them back to dry places, seeking rest and finding none. And I want you to know that bottomless pit is in the sea. It's at the bottom of the sea. That's where the abyss is found. You see, because folks, the sea is a prison for demons. That's all the sea is. And that's why you're going on the sea, boy. You're going in that ocean. You better know what you're doing, because that's the holding place of demons. That's why Jesus created the sea. That's why most demons are marine spirits. Marine spirits means demons that live in the waters. Some demons that come from the waters. And we got to know that we send them to the abyss. And that abyss is in the bottomless pit at the bottom of the sea. And that's where we send them. We don't send them and let them go into somebody else. We say, you go into the abyss. You go into dry places seeking rest and finding none. And that's that bottomless pit at the bottom of the sea. And you see, that's why in the new earth, there's not going to be any sea. There's not going to be any ocean. Why? Because there's not going to be any demons. Because the devil and all demons will be in the lake of fire, and there'll be no need for the ocean. Why? Because God will not need a holding place for demons. God created the sea as a holding place for demons. That's why there's so much evil happens on the waters. The waters is a place where evil resides. And that's why the Spirit of God hovered over the waters in Genesis 1. To make sure those demons stay where they were supposed to be. But we've got to know these things. And that's where you got to know where to send the demons when you cast them out. You send them to the abyss, which is the bottomless pit in the bottom of the sea. And God's to be glorified. Okay? So now when you start the deliverance, when you start actually to cast the spirit out, number one, you got to try your best to identify the demon by name. Then lead the person in the prayer of repentance. Get that individual to repent. Repentance take away the legal right for the demon to hold a person captive. They will not get set free unless repentance takes place. That's why repentance is so important, because the person is demonized because of sin. They opened the door for the demon to come in. They opened the door in their lives, or generationally through a generational curse, the sin of an ancestor. Sometimes you got to get them to repent of the sins of their ancestors. See, because a lot of times our ancestors died unrepentant. They died with sin on their life unrepentant. So that creates a generational curse, and it's a trickle-down effect of that generational curse to the next generation. And that's why repentance of that person's personal sin. And if there's a curse involved, get the person to repent for the sins of their ancestor and ancestors. Then get the person to renounce the sin. In other words, you break up relationship with the spirit. To renounce means to I resist, I reject, I want none of this in my life anymore. Get the person to renounce the sin. And then once the person has renounced the sin, then begin commanding the evil spirits to leave. That's when the deliverance minister now takes charge and can start commanding these spirits to leave this person in the name of Jesus, to come up and out, get out and go in Jesus' name. But you got to get them to repent and renounce. My friend, I hope this has helped you as you pursue the ministry of deliverance. I've got more information to share in this area, folks, because we're going to need to know this in the days to come. We're going to need a team. We're going to need an army of deliverance ministers, men and women, young people and older people, who know how to deal with evil spirits, how to cast them out and set people free so that they could come to be what God's called them to be. My friend, I hope this helped you, and continue to listen, because I got more information on the ministry of deliverance and casting out evil spirits. But Jesus said, in my name, you shall cast out spirits, and in my name, there's to speak with new tongues. We've got to know how to do this, folks, because the days are vastly approaching when the deliverance ministry is going to come to the forefront, and God's going to send people who need to be set free to places like the Harvest Center, places like other ministries who do deliverance, who train and teach deliverance like we do. That's where they're going to come, because God's going to send the people where they can get set free. Amen. And that's why a lot of people are going to leave these dead religious churches to find a place where they can get delivered and set free, so that they can fulfill their purpose for God in these last days. May the Lord bless you, my friend. May heaven smile upon you. May you continue to pursue the ministry of deliverance. Be like Jesus. Jesus cast out evil spirits. And Jesus said, in my name, they shall cast out demons. Mark 16, verse 17. And another sign that the kingdom of God has come is where evil spirits are being cast out. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 12, verses 25 through 28, if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God is come upon you. A sign of the kingdom is where deliverance takes place. Not just talk it, but we actually do the deliverance. That's where the kingdom of God is. And we want to be where the kingdom of God can be found. May the Lord bless you. And may heaven smile upon you. Stay strong in the Lord. Stay in the Word of God. Stay tuned to our channel. We got more good information on the ministry of deliverance and other subjects that will help you grow in the Lord. God bless you. See you next time.